Jordan. So near the time of starting that I had no time to ask if anyone must you go. Oh, young heir, must you go? She was such an excited state that it seemed to her lost on the grip of what German she knew and mixed it all up with some other language which I did not know at all. I was just about to go follow her by asking many questions when I told her that I must go at once since I was engaged. Such evident distress that I tried to comfort her, but without effect. Finally, she went down on her knees and implored me not to go, at least to wait a day or two before starting. It was all very ridiculous, but I did not feel comfortable. However, there was business to be done, and I could allow nothing to interfere with it. I therefore tried to raise her up and said as gravely as I could that I thanked her, but superstitions. When we started, the crowd around the inn door, which had been by this time swelled to a considerable size, all made the sign of the cross and pointed two fingers towards me. With some difficulty, I got a fellow passenger to tell me what they all meant. He would not answer the first, but on learning that I was English, he explained starting for an unknown place to meet an unknown man, but everyone seemed so kind-hearted and so sorrowful and so sympathetic that I could not be but touched. I shall never forget the last glimpse which I had of the inn yard and its crowd of picturesque figures, all crossing themselves as they stood around the wide archway with its background of rich foliage, a oleander in orange trees and the green tops clustered in the center. Snowy mountaintop still outside were many crosses, and as we swept by, my companions all crossed themselves. Here and there was a peasant man or woman kneeling before a shrine, who did not even turn around as we approached, but it seemed in the self-surrender of devotion to have neither eyes nor ears for the outer world. There were many things new to me, for instance, hayricks in the trees, and here and there were very beautiful masses of stems shining like silver through the delicate green of the leaves. Now and again we passed the leader wagon, the ordinary peasant's cart with its long snake-like vertebra, calculated to suit the inequalities of the road. On this were sure to be seated quite a group of homecoming peasants, the Czechs with their white and the Slovaks with their colored sheepskins, the latter carrying the lance fashion of their long staves with the axe at the end. As the evening fell and began to get very cold, and the growing twilight seemed to merge into the one dark mistiness of the gloom of the trees, oak, beech, and pine, and the valleys which ran deep between the spurs of the hills. As we ascended to the pass, the dark firs stood out snow. Sometimes, as the road was cut through the pine wood, it seemed the darkness to be closing down upon us. Great masses of grayness, which here and there bestrewed the trees, produced a particularly weird and solemn effect, which carried on the thoughts and the grim fancies engraved earlier in the evening. When the falling sunset strange relief, the ghost-like clouds, which amongst the Carpathians seemed to wind carelessly through the valleys. Sometimes the hills were so steep that despite our driver's haste, the horses could only go slowly. I wished to get down and walk up them, as we do at home, but the driver would not hear of it. "No, no, you must not walk here. The dogs are too fierce." And then he added it with what evidently meant for grim pleasantry, for he looked around to get the approving smile of the rest. "And you may have a novel of such matters before you go to sleep." The only stop he would make was at a moment's pause to light the lamps. When it grew dark, there seemed to be some excitement amongst the passengers, and they kept speaking to him one after another, as though urging him to further speed. He lashed the horses unmercifully, and his long whip, with the wild cries of encouragement, urged them on to further exhortations. Then, through the darkness, I could see some sort of patch of gray light ahead of us, though there was a cleft in the hills. The excitement of the passengers grew greater. The crazy coach rocked on its great leather springs, and swayed like a boat tossed in a stormy sea. I had to hold on. The road grew more level as we appeared to be flying along. The mountains seemed to come near to us on either side, to frown down upon us. We were entering on the Borgo Pass. One by one, several of the passengers offered me gifts, which they pressed upon me with earnestness which would have taken no denial. These were certainly of odd and varied kind, but each was given in simple good faith, with a kindly word and a blessing, and that strange mixture of fear meeting movements which I had seen outside the hotel in Bistritz, the sign of the cross and the guard against the evil eye. Then, as we flew along, the driver leaned forward, and on each side the passengers craning over the edge of the coach, peering eagerly into the darkness. It was evident that something very exciting
I had Just